That was a quick walkthrough. How many works by women artists did you encounter in all three galleries?
I saw 9 works by women artists in the first gallery, 10 in the second, and around 12 in the third.
What is your impression of the total collection of works that are displayed?
Honestly, I went through so many works by male artists, and so my first impression is that almost all the works are by male artists.
I'd like us to review our study to understand the proportion of works of art created by men and women.
I counted 48 artworks with women as subjects in Gallery 1. I'm not sure about Gallery 2, but there were 4 in Gallery 3. I found about 80 works altogether that contained women, including those with women as main subjects, and with elements associated with women, the feminine and the familial.
Over a quarter of all the works displayed. Would you say that's many?
Yes. I had expected much less, but surprisingly, there were many male artists who portrayed women as their subjects.
I see. And you counted 80 altogether. So we're looking at around 30 some artworks with women in gallery two.
Yeah.
Okay. And how many works are created by women artists? Around 30?
Yes. Wait, hold on. I think the count for Gallery 3 may be only 9, because I just cross-checked my notes with the list on the last 3 works, and these are by male artists.
I see. So there are about 28 works by women artists in the three galleries. Which ones speak most to you?
Honestly, I feel that the works in Gallery 3 are the most unique ones in terms of the variety in the depictions of women. In Gallery 2, most of the female artists did abstract work. They were already starting abstract work in Gallery 2, like Kim Lim Buddha sculptures. For these 3D forms, we need to have our own interpretation of her work, and especially like Echo from 1967. There's also one called Irrawaddy from 1979, where there are wooden pieces stacked like dominoes against the wall and on the floor.
Do you read Irrawaddy?
I find it hard to read abstract art because you often can't make heads or tails of it on its own. You have to get its context. Since I don't know this work's context, I can only assume it's more of an exploration of space in an environment or something to do with the artist's own manifesto.
Can you share what struck you most in terms of women at work in an identifiable context? In a Singapore setting?
Before we started, I was sure that there wouldn't be any depictions of women working in the collection in Gallery 1.
Why would you think that?
Because my impression was that women didn't really have an important public presence. Their expected job was home caretaking, and their primary concern would be their children. So I didn't expect to see paintings showing women in the fields and plantations. For example, there was one painting of 2 women working in a rice paddy field. I think it was painted by a male artist. It's in Gallery 1. I guess I was caught off guard because I had assumed that prior to very recent times, like from the 1990s onwards, a woman's occupation would be domestic.
Earlier, you mentioned that you noticed how the women's representation in the paintings evolved as we move from gallery one to gallery three.
I see that change from women in a domestic setting to exploring their own identity by Gallery 3. Their identity is more intertwined with objects that are associated with them, like their children or scenes of domesticity, like the cooking of food or washing of clothes.
Yeah, I agree. I think they were mainly portrayed as caretakers. In the earlier work from the 19th and early 20th century, the woman was shown with her husband, I assume, or with her children, and she is usually at home. I have noticed that there are many artworks about children and their mothers, for example, Mother and Child by Yeh Chi Wei. Later, from the 1960s, as Singapore develops, the woman in the art and the woman artist starts to have her own identity.
Do you see a loop here? At the start of our journey, we discovered in the early 19th century, women working in the plantations and fields. This subjective documentation of women working outdoors took on a different tone in the paintings of those artists who went to Bali. Then we start seeing more technique-driven creations, and women settled in stereotypical gender roles. The concern in these was less about issues, but more in exploring the painterly techniques of representation.
I think that the main change is the artistic view of females. I thought that there would be less artworks with women as the focal point, but surprisingly, many of the original drawings and paintings were of women in the naturalistic setting with flowers and fruits. There are not many sculptures on display, but the figurative sculptures were of women. I had thought that women would mostly be figures in the background, and that was quite surprising.
What period does this occur in?
Around the 1950s to 1960s. I'm referring, for example, to the paintings of Balinese women by the male artists. There were many kampong scenes with women in their homes. But there are also quite a few portraits of women with ambient background that are more focused on portraying women in various familial settings.
Why does this surprise you? Before our visit, you made a conservative estimate that we may see only 10 artworks with women on display.
That's true. Initially, I thought the 19th century artists, especially the colonial artists, had more important concerns.
Yeah, like other priorities.
Yeah, they had more pragmatic concerns in using their art, like the paintings of plantations and landscapes of the colony, for investments and for prospecting. They were part of colonial transactions then. So, I feel they were more about selling the good points of the land, what they had and what they could yield in those areas. But then, there were a few framed portraits of Chinese women. I also feel that the portrait of the woman as one half of a couple, presumably husband and wife at the beginning, and a self-portrait of Georgette Chen at the end of Gallery 1 is quite special.
How so?
These portraits showed women as independent characters.
I feel the depiction of women is dependent on what the artist is focused on. In Gallery 1, many artists focus on promoting what was in Singapore, the resources, sites, and scenes in the British colony. There were many paintings of landscapes. I feel Georgette Chen is included in Gallery 1 because she is the only woman artist that falls within this earlier period. She was a Nanyang artist, and the manifesto of a Nanyang artist was to create art style that was unique to Singapore by combining elements from the East and the West. In Gallery 2, I feel that most of the artworks focus on depicting Singapore as it was, and women played an integral role in everyday life, so they were included in these scenes. There were many more women in the paintings of the 1950s and the 1960s because they were there. Then, in Gallery 3, more female artists appeared, such as Amanda Heng. I see more performance art.
There is a question that I have to ask. Why are there so many unclothed women in Gallery 2? Usually, when they are part of the background context, they are fully clothed, going about their activities, like running a hawker business, minding their children, or working at a construction site. But when they are the focus, their top half is usually uncovered.
Are you referring specifically to the paintings by the artists who traveled to Bali and elsewhere in the region?
Yes. When they are portrayed in the background, among their village houses and with their families, they are quite conservatively dressed. So why are they naked in a close-up portrait?
It's also important to point out that there were no nudes or partially undressed women portrayed in paintings of Singapore at that time.
So this goes back to what we discussed earlier about the artists going out into places in the Southeast Asian region that seemed purer, more closely rooted to the land, in contrast with a rapidly urbanizing modern Singapore at the cusp of independence. The vernacular village settings in these neighboring places, geographically near yet environmentally distant, offered fertile ground for imagination, fresh approaches, and color palettes. Do you think the Balinese women in the 1950s were dressed like how they are depicted in the paintings? Or are they the artist's imagination? Or an exaggeration of what they see colored by exoticization?
Personally, I think the dressing might have been an exaggeration. It was the artist's impression of Bali.
They could have exaggerated the features, like smoothing the facial and body curves as an interpretation of what they saw. I noticed similar depiction of the Balinese woman by the same artists, like Liu Kang, Cheong Soo Pang, and others who went to Bali.
They saw the Balinese woman and kept depicting them the same way. This was their impressions of Bali, so that's how we know from these paintings that this is Bali.
So, I think that their drawing of the woman was an aesthetic style and less an actual depiction, more of an interpretation.
Yes, there is one painting by Liu Kang that stands out to me, Artist and Model of 1954. He painted the other artists with the eagles painting the landscape and the Balinese people.
We googled photographs of Balinese women in the 1950s and saw that there were some who were topless, but most were quite covered. I mean, there's artistic license, but these paintings portray the Balinese women quite selectively.
At a time when most were not yet traveling abroad, these paintings informed their viewers of what Balinese women looked like and dressed.
The artists probably wanted to distinguish their Balinese subjects from us, modern urban folks, with a distinctive feature.
That is a thought-provoking perspective. I'm not sure whether the artists were self-conscious or intentional about this.
Or perhaps the women in the paintings were based on the same models, and the artists simply modified their features in different settings.
No, I don't think so.
Yeah, why would that be necessary though? Since they had traveled there, would they not have simply painted what they saw in the original settings? Why would it be necessary to stage them?
Could they not have observed the scenes and painted them afterwards, using their recollection and imagination to depict the subjects?
I think the point was more to encourage people to go to Bali. I think the artist depicted the Balinese woman that way because they wanted their viewers to see the Balinese as exotic. That would encourage curiosity.
And they thought the woman in the lush settings would attract tourists?
Yes, that's just a theory though.
This is a rather unexpected point. Why would it matter to the artists if more people visit Bali?
Maybe they wanted people to visit and to see what they saw.
Yeah, by exaggerating exoticness.
But it doesn't seem like a main motive for creating the art. Maybe they just wanted to attract more people to their art.
The flashy colors would attract the tourists to the exotic.
Yes, but that's also a painterly approach of representing the tropics, like how Brazilian artists paint their warm and humid environments.
Perhaps most people from Singapore didn't know much about the Balinese, how they looked like and their lifestyles.
Well, how different do you see this from the colonizers from Britain arriving to tropical Malaya and Singapore, where everything was so different? The tropical versus the temperate climate and vegetation of the British Empire. Here, I want to bring us back from Bali to Singapore. Can we identify some works depicting women at work within the context of Singapore that, when placed side by side, could allow us to understand how the relationships between women and the environment are described across different times?
Many paintings in the last section of Gallery 1 have the same name and similar settings, so they have all kind of blended in my head, especially the ones of kampongs and Malay houses in Malaysia, with women in baju kurung.
We'll have to go further back into the 19th century to the plantations in colonial Singapore, when the urban limits were confined to the southern river mouth.
How do we consider women in their working context? There are many different types of work like women taking care of their children.
And if they're coming back from the market, is that also work?
Think for our purpose, we'll situate the women within the historical and social context, which almost invariably means that the examples you have raised are all women at work. Now, when we return to the 19th century and take the journey again to the contemporary, we will surely see a changing Singapore landscape and skyline. What, for example, were the women doing in the watercolors of Choo Keng Kwang's Temple Street of 1970? Or Leng Joo Wong's Hokkien Street of 1978? And Gog Sing Hooi's Chinatown 1980? How do we understand Singapore's urban and industrial history from the lone female construction worker in Tan Lip Seng's Tough Job of 1968 and Lai Kui Fang's Construction of Shears Bridge of 1976? When we look across the depictions of Singapore's urban and rural landscapes, there are places and objects that have disappeared. The kampongs and attap houses and streets and buildings in Chinatown, that even though they still stand, no longer exists as they once were.
There's a painting called Vanishing Scene from 1982. This work is not by a female artist and it doesn't depict female subjects, but I think it's relevant to our study of Singapore's changing landscape through the decades in the works on display. I think the artist was trying to capture fragments of Singapore, like taking snapshots of Singapore's history before they are gone. The curatorial description of the painting mentions that the artist knew many of Singapore's iconic landscapes were already disappearing at the time. Maybe he painted this to preserve his memories and enable future generations to visualize what Singapore might have looked in the past. This is like the Nanyang artist Cheong Soo Pyeong's own manifesto.
Yes, some works offer themselves more directly as archives of the built environment than others. Which of these works are created by women artists? Shall we go find out?
I'll study the works in Gallery 1.
And I'll study Gallery 3.
So let's review our observations and notes again after studying the works we have identified.